KK Heart Care Foundation of India. And on behalf of all the attendees, I extend a warm welcome to Ms. Anshuma Khetrapal, the guest speaker for the session. Ms. Khetrapal is the founding member and vice president of Indian Association of Dance Movement Therapy, founder of The Color of Grey Cells, and co-founder of the Art Therapist Collab. She's also the co-founder of CMTAI. I also extend a warm welcome to Ms. Naina Agarwal Ahuja and my co-hosts for today, Ms. Shashi Mishra and Ms. Meenu Sharma. We all know that education has evolved and undergone a sea change over years. Expectations and needs have increased multifold. Modern day learning has inspired child-centric approaches. Teachers continually seek and find ways to help students reach their potential. The new generation students of today face varied behavior, anxiety, self-management issues caused by different parenting skills, how teachers teach, examinations, as well as students' ability to use fundamentals, technology, media, self-pressure, peer pressure, just to name a few. All the mentioned factors play a vital role in increasing the stress levels in the current generation of students that we have today. Modern day teaching learning includes the implementation of additional activities in the curriculum to ensure holistic and quality education, because we as educators have realized and acknowledged the importance of helping students channel their stress and cope effectively with pressures both in and out of school. If we take my school is an example. At ASN, we have interwoven and integrated in the regular curriculum activities like art, dance, music, yoga, self-defense classes, taekwondo, and physical education, just to name a few of the activities. All these activities are used as therapeutic tools to provide an outlet for a student's feelings, anxiety, and aggression, helping students relax and teaching them how to relieve their stress is just as important as any of the basic skills that are taught in the curriculum. Moreover, all this helps raise the self-esteem of the students. We as educators take pride in how far we have come and believe in how far we can go. We never stop learning and are eager to know and learn how art therapy can be used as a creative expression to foster the overall well-being of an individual. So may I now request Ms. Shashi Mishra, faculty head of the English department, Maxford School, Rohini, to kindly take over.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kavita. It is indeed a pleasure and honor to welcome everyone in today's wonderful session by Heart Care Foundation of India. First and foremost, I would like to congratulate and thanks Ms. Naina Agarwal Ahuja for continuing the legacy of Dr. KK Agarwal ji. We at Maxford always feel at home in the workshops and webinars of Heart Care Foundation of India. Our children and children pan India have been benefited by his workshops, his webinars. And yes, this one is surely going to benefit all. Ms. Naina Agarwal Ahuja is a trustee of Dr. KK's Heart Care Foundation of India and founder of Talking Point Communication, a leading name in India. And our resource person for today, Ms. Anshuma Khetrapal, is skilled in talk therapy, trauma work, crisis intervention, family therapy, dance and drama therapy. The scholar of incredible repute, our resource person, is mental health care services professional with an MA in drama and movement therapy, focused in mind body therapies and education from the Royal Central School of Speech and Drama. My dear children, this is surely an important session for all of us as it will acquaint us to the art therapy. As Dr. Kavita has rightly said, teaching and learning in today's time is a very tough thing. One thing is that we are online, and second thing is children are under constant pressure and the anxiety. So therapies and the unique therapies play an important role. It is rightly said that art is a constant agent of transformation and is indeed the soul's drive to health. So art therapy plays a very important role in liberating us in today's cutthroat mechanism, where children are stressed, parents are stressed, even the professionals are stressed. Ladies and gentlemen, and all wonderful children, and my colleagues over here, to mention, in our school, Max Food School Rohini, we follow an integrated approach wherein art is a mandatory part of the curriculum. We have so many clubs of music, dance, drama. Even in the subjects, we are integrating art everywhere. So let's get informed about this unique therapy for solving many of our modern day problems today. Thank you. Now I would like Miss Meenu to continue. Ma'am, please unmute yourself.
So much. Yes. Thank you, Shashi ma'am. Thank you so much. And I would love to quote one of the very wonderful form of art therapy, that is poetry. And I would love to start with saying, ye sach hai ki bheed mein sabhi log acche nahi hote. लेकिन एक सच्चाई यह भी है कि अच्छे लोगों की भीड़ नहीं होती. तो सेशन को के बारे में मैं कुछ भी शुरू करने से पहले कहना चाहूंगी कि डॉक्टर के अग्रवाल वो भीड़ से अलग पहचान रखने वाला, भीड़ को रास्ता दिखाने वाले व्यक्ति थे, जिन्होंने कोरोना पीरियड में ऑनलाइन सेशंस के माध्यम से घर घर में जन जागरण शुरू किया और एक के बाद एक कोरोना अवेयरनेस और कोरोना केयर रिलेटेड इंफॉर्मेशन, नॉलेज और स्किल की कहते सुपर डुपर डोज हम सभी को फ्री में दी. और टुडे व्हाइल वी वॉश आवर हैंड्स, वी फॉलो सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग और वी फॉलो एनी ऑफ द कोरोना प्रोटोकॉल्स, वी एक्सप्रेस आवर हार्टफेल्ट सैल्यूट एंड ट्रिब्यूट टू डॉक्टर के अग्रवाल. एंड टुडे आई कांग्रेचुलेट हार्ट केयर फाउंडेशन एंड माय स्पेशल रिगार्ड गोज टू मिस नैना अग्रवाल हु ब्रॉट दिस वेरी क्रिएटिव टॉपिक इन टुडेस सेशन, दैट इज आर्ट थेरेपी. So which is essentially one of the most effective healing therapies. And art, I would say ki art is a language of mind and soul. And no wonder through medium of art therapy, we can become better version of our own selves. And no doubt through expression of art, we can teach our children to voice their stress, anxiety, their fears, and even if they have any childhood trauma or any kind of emotional pain they might be undergoing. And that too with through creative way of art therapy. So the super duper magic of art therapy is that we can feel the power of our own cosmic energy that Almighty has blessed us all with. So that becomes our inherent unique trait. And then we can have a very great insight of our own life skills that make us capable to improve quality of thoughts and our way of perceiving this world. And my respected friends, when I speak about art therapy and when I talk about our young children, then I very clearly visualize that all types of art forms, whether auditory or visual, and they are miraculously help the children to meet their neurotic needs as well, which we cannot at times feel that they have such kind of needs. So now when we have shared some few introductory facts about art therapy, I take this honor to share with you that Dr. K.K. Agarwal, he always have been pursuing this vision of promoting visual art forms among school children by medium of conducting various cultural competitions like drawing, painting, poetry, dance, character dramatization, and I remember debate, slogan writing, and much more. And I see today's session as another significant progressive step in the direction of the Jan Jagran Muhim that Dr. K.K. Agarwal had started. And for each and every person watching this session or attending the session, definitely is going to gain a lot about through art therapy session. So here I'm going to greet you all through another single line that mana andhere andhera ghana hai par chirag jalana kaha mana hai. So with that note, I invite Miss Naina Agarwal Ahuja, trustee Heart Care Foundation of India, founder, talking point communications and session chair, to moderate today's session on art therapy. welcome to Naina Agarwal. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Meena ma'am. What you said was, for Dr. KK Agarwal, the best part of his day was interacting with the children. A lot of children used to call him KK Nanu when he used to walk around. Yes. And his heart used to fill up with pride. He wanted to start. He was always passionate about educating people who are young, because that's what he felt, that if prevention starts at a very young age, only then will you live a healthy and a fruitful long life. And definitely what you mentioned, all the debates, the competitions, the inter-school competitions that we used to have, we will be carrying forward his legacy and doing the Perfect Health Mela this year as well. Of course, it will happen digitally given the current scenario. So that's something that we will get in touch with you, in the consequent sessions and update you what we are planning for all the, for the entire Mela that will take place this year as well. This is something that will definitely never stop, because learning starts at a very young age, and it is for all of us to contribute towards that and for all of us to shape young minds, especially when it comes to preventive health. He always said, use infotainment. So he coined the entire concept of infotainment, using entertainment as a means to impart healthcare education. I used to keep telling him that infotainment, there's no word like that. Like, why aren't you saying healthcare entertainment? Why aren't you saying entertainment and healthcare? Why aren't you saying health awareness through entertainment? He used to say, because children will understand infotainment, right? You're giving and imparting information to them using entertainment. So, keeping his legacy in mind and keeping his vision, let's start the session for today. I welcome Ms. Anshuma. Thank you so much for joining us. You have joined us on our other platform as well. So thank you for, gracing us again. Let's just start with, maybe you can tell everyone what art therapy is, if you can walk everyone through it. Everyone understands art, everyone understands therapy. We have different audiences here, including very young children. If you could first maybe tell them what art therapy is.
Sure. In fact, thank you everybody for organizing this and for giving me this platform to talk about a subject so close to my heart. And let's begin by not just telling you, but showing you. You know, let's experience a little bit of it. Let's really, a core principle of art therapy is to be present to what is present. What are the emotional states in our bodies, in our mind at the moment? So I heard everybody, and I also want to add a little bit about, how much Dr. KK Agarwal ended up impacting my personal life. I used to work with him in Mulchand Hospital. And we used to greet each other, and I don't think we will ever be able to really encapsulate the, impact he had overall, which I don't think even he knew about. So I just want to honor his memory, and I'm so glad to be here, to be part of this legacy. Continued legacy is really, really a privilege. And some of this also plays into how art therapy works. So what we do is, whatever the emotion is, we name it. Whatever we are feeling, we call it out. We don't put ourselves behind our emotions away and then interact with each other, right? In every other space in the world, what do we have to do? We have to put our emotions away and then we come into this space, right? Here, we honor whatever is going on for us. So as people were speaking and there were some things coming up for you, there were some things that you're feeling, we sort of bring that into the space, yeah? So for that, I'm going to invite as many of you as you can, please turn on your cameras, so that we can see and interact. And those of you who are listening on the live, please feel free to follow along. I'm going to do a small activity to get us started. Yeah, so we're just going to turn on our cameras. I'm going to give it a minute. Hi, so nice to see you guys.
Can we have all the children, teachers, parents, whoever can, to switch on their camera, please? If you can please turn on your cameras, that'll be great.
Fantastic. Because one of the things we harness in art therapy is that art is a community activity. As much as it is personal, art is also a shared activity. From time immemorial, we have been creating art. And capitalism has tried but failed to subdue art. Why? Because it must provide some very important psychological function that nothing else can provide. That's why it has prevailed, even though art has been made a product, a commodity, and we've taken away some of its experiential value. We've created a very capitalist value of it, but still it sustains, right? So let's get in touch with our bodies for now and just sort of see where we are at. So just wherever you are, straighten up a little, move your shoulders, don't sit like the, you know, the typical way. Just loosen up a little, breathe a little. Yeah, let your body breathe. Does that make sense? How does the body breathe? So strange, no, I am. I say these strange things. But the body also breathes, right? It's not just your nose and your lungs and your trachea. That's not the only function. The whole body breathes. So let your body breathe. Loosen up, little bit of here and there, little movement. If you're carrying any tension in your shoulders, some little stretch you can do, little yawn. There you are, right? Whatever you need to activate your body. And that also helps us focus actually a lot more. We can pretend to focus without using our bodies. We can all be like, hey, I'm so present, and then just be thinking about something else. But our body doesn't let us lie. Okay, so let's take a deep breath together, breathing in and out. And as you're breathing out, just sort of stretching, moving. One more time, collectively breathing in and out. As you're breathing out, just ask yourself, how am I feeling today? What part of my body is activated? Where am I carrying my feelings? Right? And one last time when we're breathing in, you're just going to move a little bit with that part of the body. Yeah? So breathing in. And as you're breathing out, just move a part of your body that has all the feelings, just to release it, relax it, really feel present in the room. Yeah, we'll do one small thing more than that. Do you have a sheet of paper besides you? If you don't have a sheet of paper, quickly grab a sheet of paper. It could be a newspaper. It could be anything, just anything besides you that you can use. If you have a notebook, you can tear out a sheet of paper if it's not too much. If it's like a proper notebook, don't tear out, huh, kids? Yeah, thank you, Shashi. So what we can do now is, with that sheet of paper, just look at it, observe it. It's just a sheet of paper. Regular, nothing special about it, right? Now what we're going to do is we're going to put all our feelings and scrunch the paper. So we're going to scrunch it. Yeah, just scrunch it. Scrunch, scrunch, scrunch. Nicely scrunch. And just let that stress and tension get into the paper. We're going to scrunch it. We're going to use our bodies. And just scrunch. Nicely roll, stretch, scrunch, whatever you want to do. So we're getting some movement in our bodies, right? And now when you've scrunched it, just hold it like this. Hold the piece of paper like this. Yeah? And have a look again. Now it's no longer just a piece of paper, right? What if I tell you that it's some sort of a creature? Yeah? What sort of creature do you see over there in that sheet of paper? Just go ahead and make it into that creature that you see. You can change it. If it has a beak or ears or anything, you can change it a little bit. You can create a little creature out of it. Could be a magical creature. It could be a creature from right now. It could be someone you know, someone you see every day. It could be a teacher, your parent. If you want, you have a pen, you want to make a little eye or something around it, you can do that. You can really make your creature. Right. And now if this creature was to have any name and a feeling that it was feeling right now, what would be the creature's name and what would be the feeling? Go ahead and use the chat function and put it down. Name of your creature and the feeling it is feeling. So those of you who can access the chat, just what is the name of your imaginary creature? And how is it feeling today? Toko the dog. Nice, Nidhansh. Cat, sleepy, sleepy cat, stretchy cat. Feeling happy. Toko the dog is happy. Lamput, excited. Bella, tension. Toto, tired. Foofy, excited. Rabbit, crushed. Bouncing Bruno. Sudden robot. That's quite nice, Josna. Leo, cutie. Tuffy, anger dog. Daksha is an anger dog. Junior, happy, fluffy elephant. Yeah, you can take as many as you want, yeah. Rambo, there's somebody who's feeling dizzy. Ladybug, such cute names. You guys are so creative. Sleepyhead, but have a gummy smile. I know that feeling. I think I'm feeling that feeling right now. Thank you for reflecting that to me. Loony, happy cat. Jenny, okay, one more minute. Quickly, everybody, put it down, put it down. Amber the cat is happy. Binny's flustered. Luna the dog. There's lots of Lunas in the room. Luna seems to be a popular one. Scoofy, running rabbit. Ella the cat is tired. Lucifer the duck. Sanchari, my God, Lucifer and all. Harry Potter, somebody found Harry Potter in their creature. Unicorn is happy. Active dog, chimney tired. Wonderful. Keep them coming. All right.
In a white rat.
There's a hungry Suzo, happy Bluey. Okay, so already see, such a small thing, but how did it help us express, right? We are expressing when we see something in something else. The principle behind this is that somewhere there is a feeling inside us also that we are projecting onto that, right? So now I'm going to invite you to close this activity. What would you like to do with this creature? If it's a tired cat, maybe you want to stretch it, you know. If it's a happy thing, maybe you want to hug it. What do you want to do? So go ahead and take your creature and do whatever you feel like doing. You may want to, it's not a good emotion. It's not good for me. I don't want to encounter it right now. I mean, I just want to keep it away. That's also okay. Don't feel like you have to protect that creature. Yeah, so we're just going to do whatever we want. There's lots of dobbies and hugs and everybody's coming into, yeah. Let it sleep. Nice. Hear songs with it. Hug it. Eating. Somebody needs to eat. Lots of hugs and kisses. So just like this, roam the whole world. So some of you are expressing your wishes. Some of you are expressing your feelings. Some of you are expressing a need and a want that you want. So just like that, such a simple 5 minutes, we were able to express so much feeling. If I had just asked you, how are you feeling? Tell me what do you want to do? You would not have expressed it in this way. But when we externalize our emotions, suddenly they become easily accessible. So that becomes a core fundamental way in which art therapy helps us. Yeah. So now we'll put our creatures aside. Thank you, everybody, for participating. And I'm going to go on and explain to you a little bit about how it works. Am I okay to share my screen?
Yes.
And anybody, yeah, thank you. Anybody who felt some emotion that's not good for you, just do a little shake off. Do a little shake off. Shake it off of you. Keep it in a box. It's not for you. You don't have to interact with it. If you felt something you want to talk about, feel free to talk to someone that you seek support from. And if you felt something great, then great, good for you. I'm glad you enjoyed that. And I'm just going to share my screen and bring to you what it means, creative arts therapy. So the actual nomenclature of what we're talking about today, sorry, can you see it? Yeah? Okay.
Yeah, we can see your screen.
Thank you so much. All right, so the actual nomenclature of how we call it, it's called creative arts psychotherapy, basically. And uske liye kya karna padta hai? How do we become a therapist? You have to go through several courses. So I've done my MA in drama and movement therapy from London, and I've done an MA in psychosocial clinical studies, right? And then I've come back to the country and sort of formed associations and companies and collaborations that help increase this field. Hamari country mein ye field abhi bahut chota hai, but we're gradually becoming bigger, including we've started a few courses in a few countries, and a lot of students are now actually enrolling in diplomas after their graduation to actually learn how to do this as well. So I'll talk about that as well. So when you think of therapy, typically this is the image that comes to our mind. Koi pareshan aadmi, pareshan insaan, note-taking person, right? Which is true. Sometimes this is what therapy looks like, but is it always like this? We'll find out. Sometimes when we talk about group therapy, this is the image that comes to our mind. We'll all talk about our feelings. We'll all sit down in a group. We'll understand each other more. Beautiful image. It can also feel a little strange. Sometimes we can have resistance. मुझे सबके सामने नहीं बोलना है. आई एम नॉट श्योर इफ एवरीबडी विल अंडरस्टैंड. सो मेनी रेजिस्टेंस इन टॉकिंग अबाउट आवर इमोशंस एंड फीलिंग्स कम अप. समटाइम्स व्हेन वी थिंक अबाउट थेरेपी वी थिंक अबाउट स्केल्स, चार्ट्स, साइकोमेट्रिक टेस्टिंग कि हमारे साथ कोई IQ टेस्ट करेगा, हमारे साथ कोई यू नो ये सब चीजें करेगा. सो देयर इज अ वेरी टिपिकल अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ व्हाट थेरेपी हैज टू लुक लाइक. ये है तो थेरेपी है, नहीं तो थेरेपी नहीं है. बट एक्चुअली therapy can be various formats. It can be individual therapy, it can be group therapy, we can have therapeutic workshops, we can do a hybrid mein we can you know have the same person who attends individual can come in for workshop, can do a group with us. Telemental health jo aajkal sirf hum telemental health mein kaam kar rahe hain, psychological first aid ye kiya jata hai un logo ke sath jinke sath koi crisis intervention ki zarurat hoti hai, trauma intervention, some big crisis has happened. After that, you need psychological first aid. So it's part of your crisis work. Counseling, jo ki kafi, you know, available rehti hai. Usually, every school will have a counselor that you can talk to. Then there'll be clinical psychologists, psychoanalysts, and then there's also creative arts therapies. So there's various kinds of work. So does this look like therapy to you? What's happening on the screen? Suddenly the image is shifted, right? From this very serious, whatever we were seeing earlier. Does this look like therapy? Yeah, kya ho raha hai? Ye therapy hai? Aisa lag raha hai? Haan, na, something? Give me a thumbs up or thumbs down. Yeah? No? Don't know? So there are people playing here. This is a workshop we did with Anganwadi workers about mental health. This is a school in Gandhi Ashram. Sorry. Then we have different kinds. In the top, in the bottom two images, you will see, you know, one, this is the same workshop. In one place, we're exploring need and longing. In the other one, we're exploring friendship, making sculptures out of our body, making costumes, making masks, making group images, making full group images, even storytelling here, there, I'm telling a story. It's not a great picture of me, but I'm telling a story. Right? Playing with the pattas, ribbons, sitting down and talking, lots of artwork. Right? So it's a very different format of psychotherapy. It's, we kind of like create projections, we create ways of expressing ourselves through the arts. That's the simplest way of explaining it. But before I get into that, what is therapy versus therapeutic? Art forms are inherently therapeutic. ठीक है? हर एक art form में हमको we feel good after dancing, we feel good after we express ourselves. Does that mean it's therapy? No. That is where the therapeutic side of things is. But therapy जो है वो अपने आप में you have to have a trained professional. You have to have a private setting. You have to have a group agreement. You're working on a common goal. All of these things is how we differentiate therapy from therapeutic. So often you'll hear people say, shopping is my therapy. I'm glad you find it helpful and it must be very therapeutic. But is it therapy? No, because therapy in itself is a profession. It's about an expertise on a subject matter. However, it's for everyone. वो जो स्टिग्मा है ना कि ओनली इफ आई एम अनवेल, मुझे जब बहुत परेशानी हो जाए, व्हेन आई कांट टेक केयर ऑफ माई सेल्फ एनी मोर, एकदम ही डिसफंक्शनैलिटी हो जाए, कोई डिसऑर्डर हो जाए, तो मुझे जाना चाहिए एक थेरेपिस्ट के साथ. आई वांट टू टेक अवे दैट स्टिग्मा. दैट इज नॉट, दैट इज परहैप्स टू लेट टू फॉर एन इंटरवेंशन. समटाइम्स यू शुड गो टू थेरेपी व्हेन यू आर फीलिंग एनी काइंड ऑफ स्ट्रेस. आपको जरूरी नहीं, यू डोंट हैव टू बी इन इट फॉर इयर्स. Even if it's a small stress or a work stress, but if you feel like you don't have the support system to actually take care of that stress, feel free to go and talk to someone, right? You're not going to wait for a pimple to become a huge boil, no, before you go and say, hey, listen, I have a pimple, right? So things like that. It's for everyone. It's for every age range. It works throughout all kinds of settings. We've worked in prison, school. We work in all kinds of setups, private workspaces. Everywhere, and it's all extremely valid work. Oh, yeah. So how does creative arts therapy differ? Creative arts therapy uses active engagement in the arts to address mental, emotional, developmental, and behavioral issues. ठीक है, ये तो आपकी हो गई definition. But what is creative arts therapy? उसमें session में क्या करते हैं? When you come in, we will engage with the arts. जो आपका थेरेपिस्ट है, दे आर ट्रेन्ड इन यूजिंग द आर्ट्स इन अ पर्टिकुलर वे. आर्ट्स तो आप अपने साथ स्कूल में भी करते हो, टीचर्स के साथ भी करते हो, बट देर इज अ सर्टन यूज ऑफ द आर्ट्स टू हेल्प यू एक्सप्रेस योरसेल्फ. एंड हाउ वी बिल्ड इट इज वेरी स्लोली. ऐसे नहीं कि फर्स्ट टाइम यू विल कम एंड वी बी लाइक चलो डन योर फीलिंग्स आउट. It's not like that. It's a very gentle language. First, we'll build rapport with you. Then we'll sit down and understand you. Then we'll consider what are your favorite art forms. How do we work with you? And slowly, slowly, gradually, we build it. So sometimes people are like, but if I'm an artist, then I'm an art therapist. Or if I'm an artist, then that means I'm doing art therapy. Or I have to be an artist in order to do art therapy. No. In fact, if you're an artist, often I will have to work with you to take away that capitalist image of art. Because an artist usually is very concentrated on the product. Ki mujhe ye bahut achha banana hai. Mujhe isko aesthetically banana hai. What we do is the process orientation. Ki hum isko kya choices lene. How are we making something? So how versus the finished product. That is the difference between art class and art therapy. Yeah, our therapy, we're just concentrating on you, your process, your choices, the way you think, who you are, why are you stressed, and expressing that through art. We don't care about how beautiful it looks or not. If it looks great, great. But that is not our concentration. Yeah. Various kinds of arts therapies, expressive arts therapies, jisme sari cheeze, sare art forms hote hain, they're all combined together. And everybody creates this kind of like, you know, some people prefer the dance, some people prefer to act, some people prefer to draw. So expressive arts therapist session would be all of these things combined. Yeah. Visual art therapy, isme sirf drawing or painting ka aapka main modality rehta hai, because it's a visual art therapy session. Drama therapy, again, main modality is drama and theater techniques. Now, it doesn't mean that we put you on stage and there is a performance. It just means that we do a role play with difficult emotions, we do some enactment of emotions, we do some talking and dialogue. It doesn't mean that it's a stage kind of theater. Okay, there's no pressure there. Dance movement therapy, again, nobody's asking you to dance. We done dance movement therapy today. How? When did we do it? Did we do it? No? Yes? Yeah? So we did it through breathing, right? Did it through a little bit of stretching, some movements, that is enough. Again, it does not have to look some like some big thing. If you want to go big and you really want to express your emotions, you're welcome to, but if you don't want to, it's okay. Music therapy, music therapists are trained and skilled in how to use sound for healing. Yeah. Narrative therapy helps you stitch your story into another kind of story, and it helps you make a narrative. Storytelling therapy, we use stories from the mythologies, we use fairy tales, and that we help you reflect. Jaise aaj aapne ek creature banaya, right? Now, is creature ka ek story hoga. Where is this creature coming from? Where did the creature go? What did it want? And then we'll talk in the idea of metaphor about your issues. Then poetry therapy, jaise Meenu ma'am ne abhi kiya tha some time ago, that expression of the self through poetry. And there are a few other formats that I'm sure I haven't included here. So what are the core principles? Mind and body are one. What we've done with the medical model sometimes is that we've created mind as separate, body as separate. But have you ever experienced anything that your body has not experienced? Of course not. When you go through life, any kind of stress and tension, your whole body feels it, right? Your heart will race, your hands will become clammy, your head will hurt when you're stressed. So why in therapy are we only talking? The entire body needs to learn how to express itself, because the mind and body are one unit. And even in core medical language, now we are shifting the language and we're saying stress is actually very important. We need to look at stress. Pehle kya hota tha? Ye to body ka disorder hai. Ye mind ka disorder hai. Now we're looking at how they are actually one. Then we're talking about the conscious and unconscious mind. Huh, there are lots of things that I already know about myself. So I can always say I'm a very self-aware person. And this is some of the language that I use to describe my experiences. But some parts of your own experiences, we are also unaware. We have either repressed them because they're too painful, or we don't talk about it and doesn't become conscious. So what happens in art is that the unconscious aspect of our body starts to express itself. Things come up which we have not expressed, which we don't expect. Did you expect before coming in that you'll make a happy dog or a sleepy cat? No, na? So when you make these things, there's an aha moment. There's a moment of insight. There's a moment of expression. And then you connect it with your real life and you bring that unconscious material into your consciousness. Yeah. In this way, we are creating aesthetic distance. Aesthetic distance matlab ye hai. Suppose there is an emotion jo mujhe nahi feel karna. It's too uncomfortable. I don't want to be an angry person, but anger aata hai. I don't want to be a sad person, but sometimes I'm sad. So when we create a distance between our emotions and ourselves, we are able to look at it, acknowledge it, and express it without feeling overwhelmed by it. So I am not angry. This cat is angry. This dog is angry. This is what's going on with them. So when we work with emotions from a distance, we can have some objectivity. Yeah, we can think about what do we want to do with it. Otherwise, we're too close to it, then we don't know what to do with it. Yeah, projective techniques also work in the same way. And we work with metaphors and roles. Okay. The one I work with especially is called drama and movement therapy, Sesame. And the Sesame approach comes from the Alibaba story. We all know the Alibaba story, right? Right. So the Alibaba story has a password. The password is open Sesame. And as soon as you open Sesame, there are treasures inside. So we think of drama, movement, visual art, all of these things as the keys, as the passwords to open the psychological function and the language of a client who's come to us to access their own treasures and resources. Hum ye nahi bolte hum aapko ye sikhayenge. Hum ye bolte hain aapke paas already hai skills. We are just going to activate it by using some techniques. Yeah. Okay, so what happens in a therapy session then? What do you think happens? Just what happened right now? Right? Did it feel like you're doing therapy? No, na. We're just playing. So a therapy session will be different according to the needs of those taking part. In every session, it's different. Everything is different. We work with various kinds of facilities, like I spoke about. The job of the therapist is to first to get to know you and to know what you are hoping to achieve. So when a client comes to me, the student is my client, right? So if for example, if the institution says they are not studying, my job is not to make you study. My job is to find out why, what's happening, what's the emotional resistance, why are you not able to study? You must be trying hard. So I will work with you to kind of consider your options and then communicate in the language to the school that, listen, this is what is going on. How can we support this person? Yeah. Once a therapist has a better understanding of your expectations, then the work can begin. So this is a typical session. You'll come in. We'll check in with you. We'll do a warm-up, some warm-up activity that will loosen your muscles, engage your imagination. We'll do a bridge-in where we start to build the theme of the main activity. Then the main activity will happen. Then we do a bridge out. And then we do a grounding so that you're ready and feeling okay to go out. So this typically takes around 60 minutes to 90 minutes. But in school settings, we've cut it down to 45 minutes to sort of match the tonality of the school, other time periods in the schools. So all of this is achieved very gently. You know, there's not a lot of demand on the client. The idea is you do as much as possible for you that day. So in that, we've got this project that we do. It's called Project Reflect. We've designed it for schools. It's a classroom-based idea. And the idea is, so what is Reflect is basically like a classroom-based concept of how to engage the whole class in a group creative arts therapy way. How we do it is by, you know, creating a curriculum with you. So it's not a curriculum that we created outside your school and we came in to deliver it. We sit down with the students, we'll sit down with you, we'll understand your needs, and then we'll create it. Right? So this is another way in which creative arts therapy is somewhat different. from other forms of therapy. Because other forms of therapy, there's a way of being. This is the right way of being. This is not the right way of being. Not all forms of therapy, but some of them, you know, like CBT and counseling techniques. Some of those techniques are about there's a wrong behavior and a right behavior. But here there is not like that. Creative Arts Therapy really works with the individual's own needs. Yeah. So we'll create that curriculum. And why? Because, of course, we already spoke about this a little bit, where people were feeling that there is a lot of pressure and stress and tension in schools right now, in classrooms right now, and in generally for students in general. And the emotional quotient actually enhances the emotional wellness of a school, really does have an impact on the studies, on your life skills, overall life. And what Dr. KK, Miss Naina was talking about, you know, catch them young. Like, it should start there. It should start with educating a person about how their mind works from a very young age, so that when they grow up, all of this behavior doesn't become a concrete block that you have to change and break. It is something that is soft, compassionate, and malleable. Yeah. So for students, it enhances your emotional literacy. We need to work on effective communication, build on assertiveness, coping with any kind of stress, trauma, and loss, decision making, problem solving. For parents, how to communicate with your child, how to bond with your child, what is the increased emotional awareness, how to talk about difficult things at home, how to, you know, consider your stress reactivity nahi hona chahiye, response hona chahiye. Hum bolte bahut hain, lekin isko karte kaise hain? Through art forms, we've actually sat down with students and teachers, or students and parents, and built a huge, you know, collage together. I want this, I want this. How do we combine and collaborate for that? How do we successfully bring our emotional values forward? So we basically create a positive relationship between all the parties. Yeah. Anyway, I've told you a very small snippet of the entire universe of creative arts therapies today. There's, of course, a lot more theory and a lot of other things. If you want to know more, there's a lot more. I also work in the education in this field. So if you want to educate yourself in this field, or you have any kind of questions, do reach out to me. I would be more than happy to answer them. Yeah.
Thank you so much. That was a wonderful presentation. And we can see a lot of questions coming in. We can see a lot of engagement, you know, amongst our audience. I'm going to take some of the questions which have come to me, and then I'll open the floor for anyone who's raised their hands, and also, you know, to the principals and the teachers who are with us, the parents, anyone who wants to ask questions. So I've got a question from Parith Gupta from class 12. How can art therapy be used to treat severe mental disorders, and how is it better than other forms of therapy? That's the first question.
I'm not going to go into better or worse. I think the needs of people are different. So there are people who would benefit from this. Even a mental disorder, even though we categorize it into a symptom and we do a checklist, every person who comes to us with psychosis has a different history, has a different trigger, has a different way of interacting with the world. So with some patients, art therapy would be wonderful. For some patients, it may not be as effective. We may have to go into psychiatry and other forms of therapy. How it interacts with, for example, in creative arts therapies, and I work a lot with bipolar disorder and schizophrenia. And what happens over there is that we actually work with the symptom as a metaphor. So schizophrenia, person who's created a world, we don't say, usko band karo, that is not functional, not good, because it's come up for a reason. You know, that world has some information. So we use it and we enhance it, actually. We enhance and we talk about the symptom, we talk about the metaphor in the symptom, and then we try and locate function. Ki isme hum fir functionality kaise lae. So that's a very broad explanation, but I'm happy to talk about it further later.
Manan Khatri from class 12 has asked, even when we are saving time of travel to school, we still find the 24 hours less. How can we manage time more efficiently and creatively?
So time management, time is also not a constant for each individual. Actually, a lot of my work sometimes with clients is about time management, because there's so many things we want to achieve in the same 24 hours. So what do? We look at what is our priority, what can be let go of, you know, what are the things that are long-term, what are my short-term pleasures that I can let go of, things like that. So it's about balancing, balancing, scaling, and then creating a creative way of interacting with time, not something punishing. Timetables and all that can be a very punitive measure. If you don't do this, this is negative. I would say reward yourself for using time efficiently. Do a positive reinforcement. Every time you use your time efficiently, give yourself a small treat. Instead of timetabling, create something like a reward system for yourself. And all of that can really help you engage with your time in a more positive manner.
Sanya Mittal is asking, how can art therapy be used to improve cognitive growth of an individual?
See, cognition is basically your patterns, right? You've formed patterns and patterns of thinking, patterns of processing your emotions, etc. So these are from your base experiences as a child, you've kind of picked up patterns and you're saying this works for me, right? So when we grow up and to whatever extent you've grown up and whatever extent the pattern has gotten concretized. In arts therapy, what we'll do is we'll actually locate where it started. And we'll try to sort of unclench the hold it has on you. So you're not going in the same circle over and over again. And cognitively, when we break some patterns, we deconstruct them gently. And we understand what they were serving. And we put that need that they were serving in another more constructive way. The need is still important. But the way you were going at it may have been maladaptive. So we look at doing the same, fulfilling the same need in a creative and positive way.
Niharika from class 11th is asking, during the tough times of the pandemic of COVID-19, the most effective affected has been the mental health of students. They've been stuck at home for almost 2 years now. How can art therapy be used for everyone here? Most of the students who are sitting at home, studying from home, they're looking at a screen throughout the day. They don't have an outlet. So how can everyone here actually use art therapy to make themselves feel better, happier, and more fulfilled?
See, I think there's two things here. One is there's a systemic issue. We are still trying to fulfill the same thing just through a different medium. It's not going to work. We're hitting walls that are insurmountable. We need to change the system a little bit. Incorporating art therapy into our system will help. So we need to do it in a scale, in a group way. We cannot do individually because individually you're again, if I give you techniques, you're again going to do it at home by yourself. Right? What's the point of that? So engagement in a system, the system needs to change to the demands of the time, which is not happening as quickly as we would want it to. So we need to adapt from a system. This is for the parents and the teachers. For the students themselves, find your medium of expression. This will be different from thing you like doing. They're two different things. I like doing this doesn't mean that I express most effectively in it. Actually, I love dancing. But when I'm dancing, I'm too concentrated on how it looks, right? How can I express myself? It's better through writing. It's a strange thing, no? But I'm better at writing down my emotions and then interacting with them. So find your medium of expression and then engage with it. If it's something like journaling, for example, how do I engage with it? I'll find different prompts every day, find different websites, find different techniques, and then I engage with the art form to help me express better. Main concern, expression, not product. I'm not looking to create something beautiful. Like seriously, that pressure, guys, take it off.
I think this answers Nandini's question as well, who's asking in the chat box that how do I release the tension that's built up because of the pandemic? So Nandini, like Anshuma said, you need to just release, you need to find a way to creatively express what you're going through. And it does not have to be something that you're the best at.
Absolutely. If it's something you're good at now, please, like, you will be too concentrated on the stress of, like, and take on the stress of creating something great. Chhod do. Wo baat kisi aur time pe karna.
Jivika is asking, can art therapy help specially abled individuals as well?
Actually, it's a very beautiful way of communicating. So typically, for example, I work with a group of PMLD, profound multiple learning disorders students. What they're doing right now is the idea is ki, oh, how can you do drama therapy there? Because they're wheelchair bound, visually impaired, hearing impaired, everything altogether. So, but you can, because the language is very metaphorical. So when I take simple metaphors, like I'll take a blue dupatta and I'll say, this is the sky. I'll take a black dupatta and say, this is the night sky. And I'll, you know, put us inside the dupatta and engage with them. Let's do our daily activities. How do you like to wake up? Oh, we are going to sleep now. So common language, common metaphor that disables the idea of disability. you know, because it's a language that's accessible to everybody. That has proved to be most effective.
Chahat had a question, which I think you've also covered, that is art therapy suitable for children under 10? So what I understand from what you're saying, anyone can, you know, engage in art therapy.
Everyone.
Yeah. Vanshika's question is, how can art therapy help a student understand and communicate their experiences to the world? Can art therapy create such an empathy that the students will share their fear and anxiety in a more comfortable way?
See, with any other therapy also, and with art therapy also, the idea is if your therapist is working with you to take away the demand on you, that no, you must express yourself, and you must express yourself in these 3-4 ways. If that is taken away, any genuine human connection helps you express. So when you sit down, when you build the empathy with yourself first, you know, a lot of us are very critical of ourselves, right? So we work on that first. How do you access your creativity when you're so critical? Yeah. If you're going to be critical about everything you do, then you can't be creative, because creativity is about risk taking, right? So we build on those fundamental factors before. Then we expand into increasing your emotional language and enhancing your values and so on and so forth. So when we take care of the fundamentals and gradually build rapport with you, yes, art therapy can achieve all the things that you've mentioned.
So this answers Swanik's question also, who spoke about self-compassion and self-esteem through art therapy. So the first part of your answer, answer actually covers that. We've got, let's take some of the people who raised their hand, and then we can go to the chat box since there are multiple questions coming in. Suman Thakur, would you want to ask your question? Om Agarwal, you want to ask your question?
Ma'am, actually, I want to ask that how your therapy will help to release the tension if we are in a, if we had an intention to learn something or to do that, how will we do in this type of tension? How your therapy will help us?
Sure. So we in therapy, for example, if you came in and you said, my problem is that I want to learn better, I will talk about what are the blocks to your learning. Maybe you're not a typical learner. Maybe the learning method that is being practiced is not working for you, which is fine. You can still go to school and get your curriculum, but you can still use different methods of learning at home. So we can use drama, visual art, poetry, build projects to help you learn. Your learning language is not necessarily the same thing that's happening in the way the curriculum is being delivered to you. So in an individualized format, I will work with you to understand what are the blocks that are coming into learning and what is your learning language actually, and how do we cover this gap between what is happening and what you want? Yeah. And slowly, gradually, you will understand better. Oh, so this is the kind of learner I am. Next time you're attending a class, you'll be like, actually, that doesn't work for me. I'm going to go home and make a project. And actually, I will learn it after reading it myself. Does that make sense?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm getting one question about, someone is talking about that in her teenage years, she's become short-tempered, which she's trying to overcome through various means, but she keeps failing each time. Can art therapy help with anger issues? And if you can give her maybe one sort of takeaway that, and everyone else here, everyone faces anger very regularly. What is a simple exercise that they can do at home?
So anger manifests in the body in different ways. Sometimes people get angry, they're very verbal in their anger. Some people are very like palpitating in their anger. Some people get clammy, some people cry. You figure out what your anger does to your body and then you undo that process. So for example, if my anger is in my breath, mostly it's in our breath, we're not able to contain it. Voice becomes like this because we're breathing like heavy, you know, hackles rising, shoulders. How do I work with it? Relax my shoulders, slow down my breathing. Control my breathing techniques, you know, count down karo apne saath, all of those things to be able to unclench the hold of the overwhelming emotion on you. So step one, identify how does that emotion affect you. Step two, start doing the opposite. Do I need, some people need distraction, yeah? And it's okay, it's a valid response. I'm getting angry with this, I'm going to come back to it. I need to walk away and I need to return. Find a language to draw that boundary. And say that, no, I'm not engaging. Even if somebody's doing something to make you angry, you're just going to disconnect and say, I'm not engaging with it. You're causing an emotion that's distressing me. I will come back to you when I'm feeling in a more reasonable frame of mind. Right? And find a distraction.
I have an anonymous question. Art therapy feels so expressive. What do you do when you're scared of admitting to yourself how you're feeling? So why would you willingly want to do it? How to get rid of that fear that you have of self, of your own self, or any kind of therapy for that matter? It all scares me. Also, the fact that for someone who constantly criticizes himself or herself, will get stressed about how bad the art is, and how can art therapy help someone like that?
I mean, you're reflecting something which every one of us feels in some degree or the other. So one, step one, you're not alone, right? This hyper-vigilant perspective of like, no, I'm the only one, everybody else seems to be comfortable, I want to take that away a little bit. You may feel it in a heightened format. Everybody else feels it in perhaps a lesser format, but it's not an invalid feeling. It's a very valid feeling. You're coming to it with experience. You've been probably, you know, whatever. You feel humiliated, ridiculed. Several things have happened to make you feel this way. So first we'll work with that. We'll work with, why are you feeling this resistance? What is making you feel like you can't express in these ways? Because it's a perfectly healthy way of expression. So whatever's coming in the middle, we'll work with that. We'll see, we'll source it. It may be that for the first 10 sessions, we'll only talk. When you feel comfortable enough to express yourself in an art form, we will take it up then. There is no hurry. Yeah, there's no goal to reach at the end of it. Even at the end of therapy, if all that we've achieved is that you're more comfortable in your body, what a wonderful thing that is. So why not?
So I think that answers someone's question around what is the difference between talk therapy and art therapy. It's a mix of both. Talk therapy can lead to more expressive art therapy.
It can.
There are a lot of questions about trust issues, self-confidence, concentration. So, given that these are all very integral to all the students here, sitting at home, they're having trust issues. They're getting, you know, anger, we've already discussed. A lot of people have concentration issues. They're not able to concentrate the right way. A lot of people may have self-esteem issues. They're looking at everyone through a screen. They're not able to get that kind of, reinforcement from their friends, from their families. So how can, if you can give some quick tips for everyone here, because there are multiple questions, different people are asking the same things.
I mean, I would be wary of giving tips, but I will say something, but like, because these are also very subjective to the individual, how you experience trust, how you experience, faith, and what has happened to make you break. I would say that the idea of trust and faith is, and in yourself and in others, is coming from some, you have to work on feeling secure within. Right? We cannot control your circumstance as much. We cannot control somebody else's actions so much. You have to locate where is the trust, or where is the gap in trust within you. How can I feel more equipped, more secure, more confident in myself? And gradually your relationships begin shifting and you start to feel more secure outside yourself also. So locating this first, circumstantially, you could have 1,000 circumstances go wrong. If you feel secure, there is a way you interact with those circumstances where you come with confidence. So that would be a broad spectrum sort of explanation here.
I have another anonymous message. It says, I have had a very traumatic past. I've seen my parents getting divorced. My grandparents have been very conservative. They've constantly taunted me. I have very disturbing memories of my childhood. I'm a teenager. I keep feeling really awful. It's like no one loves me. I don't have any friends. Mm-hmm. I don't have any support system. I'm trying to feel positive, but I'm still feeling helpless. So what do I do in such a situation? How do I express myself?
So trauma has an effect on your body. Trauma has an effect on your mind and your relationships. There is no way that you... This is not a fault of yours, first of all. I want to take away that idea of who to blame for this. The idea that you could do this differently. Sometimes circumstance doesn't allow that. Seeking help, there is no stigma here. Whatever it is you require, maybe outside your current support system. It sounds like the support system sometimes is the problem. When the support system is the problem, we can't expect the support system to resolve it for us. So we need to step outside, find a way to communicate that you need help, and find a way to express that to someone else who can help you kind of bridge that help from the outside. again, educating your family at this moment might be important about what you're going through rather than looking for a solution from them, which they may not be able to provide. I'm sorry you're going through that, by the way.
Before I get to the other questions, we're already at 5 o'clock. Any of our co-hosts have any questions, that they've received from the students, Dr. Kavita, Shashi ma'am, Meenu ma'am?
I read in the chat box, one of the students asked, I'm not very good in art. Yes. So still, can I go for any kind of art therapy? What art therapy is suitable for the person? So that was coming up again and again, and I found it very, genuine query. I am not an art person. I cannot draw, I cannot paint. What can I do then?
I mean, Minuji, it's very hard to work with art people. Yeah, people, the idea is you have to do a lot of unlearning before you can actually access art therapy. So if you're not good at art, congratulations. That's a wonderful skill. Please bring it into therapy. Because then whatever will come out of you will be a process, will be choices that are authentic and not be, guided towards the process of making beautiful art, right? So the less you know of art, the better it is. That the principles will work with you actually much more.
Very wonderful session, Nana, ma'am, and ma'am. My question is that from past 1.5 years, or most probably, let's say 2 years, we're surrounded by a lot of negativity. Mm. We are behind the bars.
Yeah.
So my question is that how will art therapy develop our own mental health and make us better versions of our own self rather than imitating or aping others? Please tell me.
Absolutely. So what you're talking about is the context and the circumstance, right? We cannot exist outside of our circumstance. Our resilience has been tested and then some. We've lost and more loss. We started this session with acknowledging a great loss and grievance. So the idea is acknowledgement. We cannot circumvent it. We cannot say this has not happened. We'll just keep pretending that everything is fine. We'll just go back to our old resources. You have to build new resources to tackle this new circumstance. We cannot expect our old resources to work here. What were your old resources? You were able to take a walk, you were able to go to dance class, you were able to go express yourself, meet your friends. Now you're not able to do that. What does new resources look like? Art therapy can help you explore what are these new resources I need to build and develop in my life so that I can do this by myself in this new situation. Right? How do I express grief at this point when I can't even go through the rituals that are required for grief, for example? So it's such a terrible time that I can't go through those rituals. So then what do I do? Do I just sit and express without expression? Those rituals are designed to express ourselves, right? The 13 days and 14 days that we go through in our culture, they're designed to express ourselves. Without going through those, the grief will still stay in our body. How do we still maintain that expression without going through that grief? We now have to work with our support systems to find new resources. That would be my broad answer. But of course, with each individual, those resources differ.
Sorry, I have one more anonymous question in the chat, and I'm taking the anonymous questions because these people seem like they need someone to talk to. I constantly feel like things I want to say come out completely differently from what I want to say. I end up hurting or offending people, and anyone I talk to tells me that it may be depression or it's for an excuse for you to get away with anything, so I keep getting blamed for it. How do I tell them that I actually need help and not to make it worse?
Well, that's a hard one again. So it sounds typical of reactivity, post-trauma. Or it could be reactivity post some sort of repression of anger. Do you have healthy spaces in which you're able to communicate your anger and your negative emotions? That is primary. And everybody keeps telling you to be positive. The toxicity to that, to constantly being asked to be positive, is good for others, not good for you. You know, so first of all, this pressure we put on ourselves, be positive, think positive. Take that away. It's okay to have natural human emotions. You have brain chemicals that are directing you towards trauma, towards anger, towards sadness. Accept that. Acknowledge. Acknowledge that these are realities that you are going through. And then what are the avenues you need? Think about it, write about it, consider it. Spend some time by yourself without distraction and really consider what does your mental health journey require and take those steps.
Okay.
any, I know there are a few hands which have been raised. Kavita ma'am, Dr. Kavita, you have a question. You're on mute, ma'am.
I have one question that now that we have attended this session, many students will come up with an idea to give their teachers that why don't we resort to art therapy, ma'am, because we cannot cope with XYZ issues. So now my question is that, okay, if we resort to this kind of an art therapy, what kind of special training or how can the teachers go about interpreting the art therapy? Because what I understand is that children come up with closed figures, open figures, etc., as is the very, a very generalized way of speaking about it. But how can the teachers go about using art therapy in the right manner?
First of all, I will speak to the importance of training. The idea of art being therapeutic, sure. But then what will come out of it might be very overwhelming for someone. So you need to know how to contain it. You need to learn how to redirect that into a constructive format, because no therapy is better than bad therapy, ma'am. Right? Like not touching something and then after touching it and assuring that person that you will be taken care of, if we actually don't take care of it, it breaks the trust even further. So the lack of adequate training in this country has many consequences. There are directories and websites that I can send to you all about how to find a therapist near you, how to find a professional, and together we can create an atmosphere of therapy in the classrooms. Therapy then becomes, the same person cannot be the person delivering the curriculum, teaching, and being your therapist. Those are two contradictory roles. To deliver curriculum, you need a certain level of skill, and to develop this, you need a certain kind of different role. The same person can do it, but not in the same setting. I'm also a teacher, but in the same place where I'm a teacher, I am not a therapist. Because the way I have to interact with my students, the boundaries I have to do to create my teaching atmosphere, very different. When I finally meet them as a therapist, they will not be able to attach themselves to me because I'm also their teacher. They will not be authentic with me. They will hold back because they will think of all the kinds of consequences that they can face. So this is a different section altogether that needs to be built up. This is what I was talking about when I said system mein hame changes lane hai, right? So if you are interested in building that system, there are various levels of trainings that are already happening in this country. We can get some people in to make a kind of like an ecosystem within your schools to be able to take this forward. For teachers, what we do is workshops where we train teachers on how to bring in art forms into their teaching and how to build rapport with their students, which is not about keep quiet and do this and do that, but actually really bringing their emotionality and their subject matter together. So that level of training we can do, but therapy itself, the delivery of the therapy, it's best to have it done by someone else.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you.
I know we've run out of time. We're still getting a lot of questions which are coming in. As a part of Dr. KK's Heartcare Foundation of India, we do run a free OPD on Zoom where we have a psychologist and a counselor who's available on Wednesdays between 3 and 5 p.m. Every Wednesday, she's there. Of course, if there are more queries coming in, if there are more requests coming in, we can add one more day in the week for the session. We had the psychologist coming in because of the COVID pandemic. A lot of people that we were treating as a part of the pre-OPD had, trauma, had loss in their families, had a lot of emergencies due to oxygen shortage, due to the entire family testing COVID positive. So I'm going to put that OPD link in the chat in case anyone here feels that they need to speak to someone. If they're alone, if they want some sort of counseling, they can definitely reach out there. If someone wants art therapy, of course, she's not an art therapist. If you want art therapist, you can always contact Anshuma, who will be able to help in that regard as well. We are also running a free OPD for COVID and related illnesses, where we have different doctors on the platform. That's from 3 to 5 p.m. every day on the same link. So in case you know anyone in need, this is a service that we're doing for the society. It doesn't matter who it is. Anyone who needs help, we want to be there for them. And that's something Dr. KK had started, and that was something that we are carrying forward. So I have just put on chat the psychologist and the counselor who's available from 3 to 5 p.m. every Wednesday. I have also put in chat the virtual OPD that we are running, where anyone can join in any day in case you know they're needing any sort of medical counseling, and you know we would be able to help them in that regard.
I just want to say before we close, thank you everybody. I'm sorry to have left some of you unanswered. Thank you for bringing your questions. There is space for these conversations outside of the scope also. Somebody asked my Insta handle, I've just put it there. You also have my email. In case you want to reach out and start something, start therapy, start sessions, if I'm not available, I have a team of therapists and we also have other services. So, you know, all your questions and all the time is honored and acknowledged. But unfortunately, the scope of this particular session has remained limited, which I will keep in mind later on. We'll just do a Q&A or something like that at some other point of time. But thanks a lot for articulating those questions. The step of articulating those questions itself is sometimes very important. You know, that the fact that this session brought you to what is it that you need to address, and you've gone ahead and articulated that question, that is an enough step for now. For some of you, right? And then using your support systems to take this question further, that can happen at another time. But thank you for articulating at all. And thank you for participating. I'm very grateful.
Shashi ma'am, can I ask you to give the word of thanks and to end the session?
Once again, a very cheerful evening to everyone. First and foremost, I would like to congratulate Nanaji. Truly, you ask me, I felt that Dr. K.K. Agarwalji's positivity and his service to humanity permeated the ambience of this webinar. Secondly, I would like to thank Anshuma Ji. We felt like we are talking to another friend. It was not like we were talking to a professional. You listened to us. You solved so many of the children's queries so well, ma'am. Thank you so much. Gratitude makes sense of our past, brings peace today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. Thankfulness is the beginning of gratitude, and gratitude is the completion of thankfulness. I, Shashi Mishra, feel privileged to be bestowed with the opportunity to propose the vote of thanks. First and foremost, we offer our sincere thanks to our resource person, Ms. Anshuma Kshetrapal, a eminent scholar, skilled in talk therapy, dance and drama therapy, who in spite of her busy schedule, accepted the invitation of CFI and graced this session with her benign presence. Ma'am, our words may not be capable of communicating our sense, as I already said, but certainly we feel honored to have such eminent personality amongst us. Secondly, I extend my gratitude to Ms. Naina Agarwal Ahuja Ji and her entire team of CFI. And as you said about Health Mela, our children are eagerly waiting for this year's Health Mela also. Your expert and able moderation has really helped us today. It is needless to say that today's program would not have been such a great success without your continuous supervision. I would also like to extend my thanks to the respected principals of the schools for allowing their children to get benefited from the sessions. I also extend my sincere thanks to all the attendees for giving their time. We shall remember everyone's contribution in making this webinar a success. Once again, we thank each and everyone present here and all our collaborators, parents, teachers, for your commitment and cooperation towards the building up of this source of learning. May God bless each one of you and take care of yourself and your family in this time of pandemic. I once again thank everyone for their cooperation in making today's webinar successful. Thank you, Nanaji.
Thank you, Shashi ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for joining.